We're very happy to present now a very powerful presentation by Ricardo Montalban on the Fatima message. We receive very special permission from St. Gabriel Media to present this program, and the first half will be presented now, and the second half will be presented on our last presentation next week. Now, we're asking you to take your books home with you now after this presentation and really set time aside to read and to reflect on the Fatima message, and also to refer to our Family Consecration Prayer Book. And definitely, in this next week, read number 42 and number 44 in our Family Consecration Prayer Books, number 42 and 44. And after you see this presentation on the Fatima message, I think after these readings, you'll start to understand their power. Now let's go to the presentation.
Has either surrendered or been killed.
Assassination and revolution, companions of change. Braganza noblemen have ruled Portugal for centuries. Now, with King Carlos dead, a republic replaced the monarchy. But more than the government had changed. Portugal, one of the most Catholic countries in the world, was subjected to religious persecution. These victorious revolutionaries saw the church as their enemy. It had supported the state and must pay a price. One action among many was to exile the church's highest authority, the Cardinal Patriarch. They sought social change, political objectives, but there was much more at stake. What they could not see was their role in an emerging grand design, a mosaic that reveals itself only when we look at a series of seemingly unrelated events. Events that many believe hold profound significance for the world today. Pieces of the puzzle include a world at war, Rasputin, his unnatural power, his violent death, execution of Nicholas II, Tsar of Russia, the slaying of the Empress and their children, the Bolshevik Revolution, Lenin's rise to power, and the strange and beautiful experience of three children. Young shepherds tending their flock amid the Serra da Aire mountains of Portugal in the year 1917. More than 70,000 experienced the climax to the children's story. Among this crowd are five people who will tell us what they saw. Five witnesses to the miracle of the sun. What really happened at the Cova da Iria in 1917? We'll examine the events and their implications for us, for our time. Is there a thread that can be followed that ties past to present and present to our future, that explains why millions throughout the world remember three shepherd children? Why millions are committed to act, to respond to the message of Fatima?
It doesn't seem to me this can be dismissed as an illusion, much less as a hoax or a fraud. Something happened there.
And then they said that Our Lady asked them to continue to go to the Covaderia every 13th of every month.
I look upon the miraculous happenings with skepticism. On the other hand, I know that the miraculous happenings do happen.
went together with four young men because we were thinking
what
that...
What could we do?
That could be something
bad.
Bad
people, bad
It could
people.
Be something bad, he said.
There were many in the church who were skeptical, so the church wasn't pushing for this. The church wasn't encouraging people to believe it. They came because they did believe what they had heard, and this kind of event of this magnitude is just not that common, especially in our time, where there is so much unbelief.
Belief, disbelief. Three children had predicted a public miracle. Identify the date, time, and place. An extraordinary event had occurred. Newspaper accounts appeared worldwide. They referred to the miracle of the sun. Many expressed great doubt. There was skepticism concerning the dancing sun, the prophecies, the secret, the message of Fatima. In the past, revelation was widely accepted as a source of knowledge. Why not today, in the age of science, an age influenced by technology and humanism? Dr. Paul Kurtz offers an answer.
I think what's very important in the present loss of spirituality is the development of the Renaissance first, with the secularization of morals, and second, the development of modern science. With modern science, the great emphasis is upon reason and evidence and on the sense that man can control his own destiny. And so the modern world has this whole theme that man is the center of concern and not God.
You know, all these inventions that we are so proud of have taken place in my lifetime. I remember the world when there was no electricity, no telephone, no macadamized roads, no motor cars, none of these things.
In these images of progress, we see man as inventor, builder, dreamer. By the year 1914, many have come to believe all problems can be solved. Only good can follow the applications of scientific knowledge. Solutions packaged in a box labeled progress. Out of that box comes the specter of World War I. It's the summer of 1916, the summer of Verdun, the Battle of the Somme. There is intense suffering on both sides. 2.25 million casualties on the Western Front. It would seem no place on Earth could be further removed from the destruction, the horror of war, than the Serra d'Aire mountains of Portugal, where farmers and shepherds regard the conflict as little more than a distant rumor. Fatima, 1917. For three young children tending their sheep, it is the best of times. Warner Brothers portray them, Hollywood fashion, in a feature film released in 1952. Here, in fact, are the very children. Lucia dos Santos, age 10. Her cousin, Jacinta Marto, 7. And Jacinta's brother, 9-year-old Francisco.
They would go through the trap door when the family was gone and hide above us. They were there and we didn't know it. The three would hide for hours, always playing, running, jumping, hiding under the stairs. Yes, they were like all children, hiding, joking, always playing together.
That winter, huge armies battle each other and the elements. Trench warfare continues. The slaughter continues. Three shepherd children who could neither read nor write, living in a small village 90 miles from Lisbon, might have limited knowledge of the Great War. But to better understand what happened to them in 1917, we need to examine historical events of which they could have little knowledge, if any. Events unfolding thousands of miles away in Russia. It's the world's largest single state, ruled for centuries by an arrogant autocracy, ruled by the Tsar in the name of God. For these last of the European serfs to be freed, life was harsh, filled with injustices. Ownership of the land was a crucial issue. In the cities, those whose backs were bent under the yoke of the Industrial Revolution faced new dangers, new fears, old tyrannies. By the turn of the century, there were widespread disturbances fed by bitterness, hopelessness. Father Giorgi Gapon organized a society of workers. They sought to present a peaceful petition for relief, and on a Sunday in January 1905, marched on the Winter Palace at St. Petersburg. Marched singing, "God Save the Tsar." The Emperor's troops fired into the crowd. Hundreds were mowed down. It was Bloody Sunday. Portraits of the Tsar and the crosses they carried fell with them. Autumn 1905. Following a general strike in the city, a frightened Nicholas II agrees to the formation of a legislative council. It would have limited powers and be called the Duma. The people would see little change in their lives.
In the later years of his reign, particularly just before World War I, the advisors became increasingly under the control of Rasputin, the so-called monk who was the most evil influence on Nicholas, and his wife became a bad influence because she was more concerned than anything else with the survival of her son, who had hemophilia, and she believed that only Rasputin could heal him, could make him well when he had one of the bleeding episodes, and therefore the whole government came increasingly under Rasputin's control, whom everyone knew outside the Tsar's family to be an evil man. There is no evidence that Rasputin had any sincere religious belief at all. There is some evidence that he was involved, at least in his early years, in various satanic cults and rites. There is very substantial evidence that toward the end of his life, he possessed supernatural powers of satanic origin. It is the clearest case that I know of in history where a man who played a major historic role at a critical moment in history, where there is substantial, solid evidence that he was exercising powers which could only have come from hell.
1914, Russia is drawn into World War I. Poorly trained, poorly armed, their first year in battle, 2 million Russians are killed, wounded, or captured.
Every great war from the 19th century on had led to a crisis in this essentially static, agrarian, militarized empire. And World War I being the most destructive, the most psychologically destructive as well as physically disruptive war of modern times, really, in many ways, it hit the Russian Empire just like a thunderclap, and it wasn't able ever really to recover.
Rasputin's influence over government appointments and decisions proves disastrous. So long as he lives, his power over the Empress, and therefore the nation, will be complete. Russian statesmen, and even some members of the royal family, convinced the fate of their country is at stake, seek his death. Rasputin is lured to Prince Yusupov's home and is poisoned, shot, beaten, finally drowned. March 1917. Holy Mother Russia, disillusioned by military defeats, unable to meet the very basic needs of her people, sees starvation, food riots, rebellion. The Tsar's government is not overthrown, it collapses. Within 16 months, a Rasputin prophecy will be fulfilled with the death of the royal family. The Bolsheviks will execute Nicholas, Alexandra, and their children. A provisional democratic government prepares for an election. Under the new freedoms, revolutionaries, enemies of the imperial regime, return to Russia.
A great many revolutionaries came back from abroad. Stalin and Molotov were in Siberia. Lenin was in Zurich, in Switzerland. The Bolsheviks were one of the smallest of the parties within the broad coalition of revolutionary parties, but they took advantage of the freedoms. Lenin came back in April 1917 on the so-called sealed train, as Churchill once put it, sealed like a plague bacillus.
Lenin, there's a fundamental importance in understanding the Russian Revolution. It could not have happened without him. All of the other situations that existed that made a revolution possible, that sort of opened the way to it, none of them would have resulted in a revolution, in my opinion, if it hadn't been for Lenin's presence. Lenin's presence was critical, determined to destroy the whole existing system in Russia as he was. He achieved his objective and brought a horror upon his native land, which is still there. The Russian Revolution of 1917 is the most important secular event in the history of this century. Just as the apparition of Our Lady of Fatima, which came at the same time, could well be described as the most important religious event, and the two are obviously very closely related.
By 1917, Portugal's been drawn into the war. But in the many small Portuguese villages, issues involved in the conflict and the rise of Marxism in Russia are little known or debated, certainly not understood by the children. Better known is the revolution that touched their own lives since the assassination of King Carlos.
In 1910, with the change of the regime under the leadership of Masons, the church came under attack. The new government promised that within two generations, they would make an end of religion and faith in Portugal. This was the beginning of the persecution of the church.
In Lisbon and in other large cities, church property is seized. Hundreds of priests and nuns imprisoned or exiled. Those allowed to remain are forbidden to wear clerical dress. The traditional Catholic matrimonial mass is not allowed. Marriages are authorized by civil contract only. The great monasteries and abbeys are converted into barracks and government buildings. In the cities, church authorities experience a reign of terror. In the remote village of Fatima, conditions are less severe. They have a priest, Father Ferreira. May 13th, 1917, in a grassy depression among the hills outside the village, 10-year-old Lucia dos Santos and cousins Jacinta and Francisco first see the Lady of Fatima. Lucia remains the only living witness. The children will undergo many interrogations. For a graphic description of what occurred, we turn to those transcripts and to Lucia's memoirs written in 1935.
It was a clear day, the sun shining, when at noontime suddenly we saw a flash of lightning. We began to run, then ahead of us, we saw a beautiful lady, about 16 years of age, dressed all in white. She was surrounded by a brilliant radiance. We stopped about 5 feet away from where she was standing, atop a small evergreen. She said, "Do not be afraid." I asked where she came from. "I am from heaven," she said. "I've come to ask you to come here for 6 months in succession, on the 13th day, at this same hour. Then I'll tell you who I am and what I wish."
The beautiful lady then asked if the children would be willing to accept certain sufferings that would come to them and offer those sufferings to God so that sinners would be converted. Lucia replied, "Yes, we will." They were asked to pray the rosary every day to obtain peace for the world and an end to the war. She then began to rise serenely, going up toward the east and disappeared in the immensity of space. Francisco sees the apparition, but cannot hear what is said. Jacinta and Lucia see and hear all, but it is Lucia alone with whom the lady speaks. And it is Lucia who warns her cousins not to tell anyone what has happened. 7-year-old Jacinta, unable to contain her happiness, tells her parents. They are puzzled, but know their two youngest children are truthful. When the story reaches Lucia's mother and father, the reaction is quite different. From Lucia's mother, a devout Catholic, there is total disbelief. Then harsh words and threats to persuade the child to give up this tale. Despite her mother's anger, even beatings, despite ridicule and abuse from others in the village, Lucia and her cousins wait in great expectation for June 13th. Wait to see again the Lady of Fatima, the lady they believe to be the Virgin Mary. Feast day of St. Anthony, June 13th, a holiday atmosphere eagerly awaited by all the children of the village. But Lucia, Jacinta, and Francisco are not diverted. They return to the cova as the lady requested. Word of the May apparition has spread. There are more than 50 strangers present. The children's parents are not there.
We were there, five young men with our staves of wood, to protect my cousin Lucia, to protect the children. It was rumored there might be trouble. They were finishing praying the rosary when we got there, and we sat down. The children pointed, that's where the lightning came from before. And soon after, the lightning did come, a live lightning. Then they said, kneel in front of Our Lady and raise your hands. We were standing there in front of her like a piece of wood, afraid that something bad was going
afraid.
To happen.
We were afraid.
Lucia, Jacinta, and Francisco knelt before Our Lady. Lucia asked, what do you want today?
Lucia said, kneel, because Our Lady is coming. And Lucia, Jacinta, and Francisco did kneel.
Some people thought it was a hoax. Others thought it might be about the end of the war.
No one else sees the Lady of Fatima. But the children say she came in the same way and to the same place, atop a small 3-foot evergreen. As before, Lucia speaks freely with the beautiful lady and asks her to take them to heaven with her.
Yes, Jacinta and Francisco, I will take soon. But you are to stay here some time longer. Jesus wishes to make use of you to make me acknowledged and loved. I wish you to come here on the 13th of next month to pray the rosary every day and learn to read. Later, I will tell you what I want.
The children are questioned by their parish priest. Father Ferreira says they are telling the truth about what they believe they saw. But the priest is deeply worried. He tells them it might be a deception of the devil. Terrified, Lucia decides not to return to the Cova d'Iria July 13th. The Passchendaele Offensive, launched by the Allies. It is July 1917. The British will attack in the mud for 3 nightmarish months. Their destination? Submarine pens on the Belgian coast, 40 miles away. Poet Paul Nash captures the horror. Evil and the incarnate fiend is master of this war. No glimmer of God's hand anywhere. The rain drives on, the shells never cease. Annihilating, maiming, maddening, they plunge into the grave which is this land, one huge grave. It is unspeakable, godless, hopeless. Noon, July 13th, the devout and the curious gather in the cova. They wait to see what will happen. Despite her fears, at the last minute, Lucia decides to join her two cousins.
My sister and my aunt were there with Lucia. There were many people behind the walls. The stones where today we find the basilica. We could see only the heads, looking and observing. And when we came down the road, a man said to me, "Hey, young man, why are you going there? Don't you think that it could be some punishment sent by God?" We stayed like that, stiff. And then I thought, my sister and my aunt are there. If they go, everybody should go together.
This day's message from the Lady of Fatima is the most serious of all. A prophecy. A warning that will hold profound significance for our world today. Lucia asks the lady for a miracle so that all will believe the message. The answer? In October, I will perform a miracle. What happened next would have been more than they could bear had they not been told all three would go to heaven. For the children were then shown a momentary vision of hell, followed by this prophecy.
The war is going to end, but if people do not cease offending God, a worse one will break out during the pontificate of Pius XI. When you see a night illumined by an unknown light, know that this is the great sign given you by God, that he is about to punish the world for its crimes by means of war, famine, and persecutions of the Church and the Holy Father.
The prophecy continues. If people do not stop offending God, Russia will spread errors throughout the world. The good will be martyred, several nations annihilated, but that in the end, a certain period of peace will be granted the world. Then the three are told a secret to be given only to the Pope.
The children reported at Fatima that Mary had asked for prayers for the conversion of Russia, that she had foretold that in fact Russia eventually would be converted, that Russia would spread many errors throughout the world prior to its conversion, and that there would be the destruction of nations as part of that process.
Educated, knowledgeable Portuguese were astonished at the inclusion of Russia in the children's reports. Russia? Unable to feed its own people, economically depressed, third from the bottom in world literacy, on the verge of a revolution? Russia? Hardly a prospect to become a world fit, a superpower state.
It's rather interesting from a historical point of view because the Bolshevik Revolution had not as yet occurred when the appearance at Fatima took place. It was still a couple of months in the future. And even had it occurred, it's unlikely that these three peasant children in Portugal would have comprehended what was involved. Ostensibly, in 1917, Russia was still a very religious nation. It belonged to the Russian Orthodox Church, was very religious, one of the most religious nations in the world. So it's rather interesting that they should cast Russia in the role of the disseminator of false ideas and speak of the need for Russia's conversion, which is not what people would have thought about it in 1917.
After the visitation, the children repeat the promise of the Virgin Mary. A miracle will occur October 13th. And how do others, even those who are present, respond to their words? Most consider the children's report a work of fiction, unacceptable, unbelievable. The children seek ways to sacrifice, to obtain the conversion of sinners, to save them from the hell they have seen. Their lunches, they give to poorer children. When thirsty, they drink no water. Again, each child is questioned by Father Ferreira. This time, the priest, the pastor, remains silent. Covadairia, August 13th, 1917. 6,000 people gather for the announced visitation, but the anti-religious government, increasingly concerned by reports of apparitions and the growing crowds, takes action. Administrator of the district, Arturo de Oliveira Santos, unable to persuade the children to change their story, kidnaps them. At Covadairia, there is no visitation. Bitter, disappointed pilgrims return to their homes, for some a distance of many miles.